in terms of articles, I think about and I kind of think about for the five elements of Te Tiriti, and the first being the preamble, which essentially says that the British and Hapu are entering into a relationship. And so that's at the heart of Te Tiriti, that it's about a relationship, and it acknowledges that there's some settlers here and there's more settlers going to come, and Hobson's going to be the governor. So it's pretty straightforward. The first article is about honourable kāwanatanga. The hapu grant to the British the right to govern their people. It's really critical in terms of that it's about the British being able to govern non-Māori. That was never surrendered, eh? Even that middle management never went. It was about kāwanatanga is about looking after the non-Māori. And then Article 2 is about tino rangatiratanga, so it reaffirms what was already outlined in he whakaputanga, that hapu were in charge, it was over all things that were important to them. And tucked at the back of Article 2 is the real estate clause, eh?
Yes.
And the real estate clause, if you want to sell your land, sell it through the Crown and they'll make sure you don't get ripped off.
Yes.
And then the third one, of course, is where the British granted to hapu the right to have the same rights and privileges as British subjects. And then there's the oral article that people don't always talk about. But what you say is as important as what you write down even back in the day. And there was a whole lot of missionaries there on the day and on the action, and there was agreement about cultural and religious freedom.
Yes.
But they're way more deep and complex than that. I'm sure you've got more to say.
Yeah, well, in terms of I te mount, tēnei kawenata, Māori treated it as a covenant because they knew what a covenant was. They've had 20 years, 30 years experience of the Bible, so they understood what all those terms were. So therefore, in terms of the treaty, he kawenata. Ko te kawenata, tūturu, he hono ki te whenua, he hono ki te tangata, he hono ki te atua. And with all those three elements together, he tapu, it was sacred. And so this is how they treated he tapu, te kawenata nei. Ko ia rātou, I kaha ki te pupuri, I kaha ki te mau, ki te kawenata, I tāngi o rātou moko. O rātou moko ki runga i te kawenata, ko te pā, ko ngā moko. Nā reira, ki te pērā, ko whakaaitia, tuātu i tērā, ko whakatapu. Tēnei mea te hoko whenua. Ki hei oku tupuna i mōhio tika ki tēnei mea o te hoko. Hoko whenua, ki hei oku tupuna i pērā ki ngā whenua. I te mea e hara no rātou te whenua. Ko rātou whakaaro, ngā kaiteki, ko rātou ngā kaiteki o te whenua, e kore tāia e rātou te mea nāku tēnā whenua. And so it's in terms of the words that they used, and nāku means that I own it, all right? And I'm in charge of it, and it can be treated in the way that I can treat it. But whenua doesn't have that relationship. And so when you have a relationship with that kind of thing, the word that they use was noku. Noku te whenua, I have connection, relationship with the land, but I don't own it and I don't control it. It controls me. So ko e tēnā ko ngā whakaaro i roto i ngā mātua. It wasn't a thing to be treated as being able to sell off. Engari, kia teki tika. So they were very particular about how they wanted the interactions with lands. And they wanted to ensure that the land wasn't defiled.